Yep. Good morning, everyone. This is the COA board meeting for February. And I'm going to begin with the statement. Pursuant to current state law, this meeting of the Council on Aging Board is being conducted via remote participation. Persons who would like to listen or view this meeting while in progress may do so by Zoom or by phone. The meeting is being recorded by the Town of Bedford. All votes taken by this body shall be by roll call. Okay. We have a quorum present. And I'm just going to go through the roll. Lou?
Yes.
Present?
Present. And accounted for.
Yes, sir. And Mary Lou?
Present.
And Mary Lou will be our acting clerk for today. Thank you, Mary Lou. Sandra?
Here.
And Jean? You get it, Jean?
You're muted.
Here.
Oh, very good. So Cindy is not present today. She's indicated that she has a dental procedure. So I'm sure she'd rather be anywhere but where she is. So that will take care of her. I've also received a notice from Virginia Wang indicating to me that she's resigning from the board. She has, I believe, tendered her resignation to the volunteer committee and to the select board. We will note that. So if you know of anyone who would be a good candidate for the board, encourage them to do so. We're short now and would like to have a full complement. I should acknowledge that I'm also present, since I didn't indicate that by name. Ellen? Bobby is presently absent, but we expect her to join. So note that she's not present at the start of the meeting, Mary Lou.
Okay.
And what about Tom?
Yes. I thought I sent him. Sorry.
I sent them both the links this morning.
We haven't heard from Tom, so I suspect he could join us. He may be having difficulties as well, technically. Okay. Now, I'm going to share with you just a little future planning here for the remainder of our meetings through the end of June. This month, Sandra is going to focus on housing. March, Mary Lou indicates she's going to lead the conversation with respect to diversity. And Tom has agreed to serve as the acting clerk. Then in April, Tom, and I hope Lou, if you can work with him, I'd like to focus on transportation. And Gene has indicated that he will that he will take the minutes for that meeting. And then in May, Gene is going to lead the conversation with respect to communications and messaging. And that will leave us June, which Allison and I will try to tie up any loose ends that we've got, including the topic of governance. At this stage, I'm not sure how lengthy that conversation is, but we will be comparing and researching that over the next couple of months. So that's the plan. Just so everybody is aware of it. Okay. Now then, turning to the minutes from the January meeting. Are there any corrections to the minutes? Yes, Sandra?
Even though I did them, I did find a couple of typos, so I'll just correct those when I look back at it before sending it on to Allison.
That's fine. Very good. Any other corrections? Okay. And all those in favor, we're supposed to do it by roll call. I'm sorry. Okay. Sandra?
Yes.
Lou?
Yes.
Mary Lou?
Yes.
Actually, do we need a motion?
I thought I made it.
Oh, okay.
If not, we should second it too, probably.
Yeah. So I seconded if you made it.
Yeah. Oh, good. Tom's joining. Good morning, Tom. You're muted.
Okay, I'm now unmuted.
Yep, thanks. We were just dealing with the minutes from January. We've determined that there are a few edits, that typo edits that Sandra is going to make. We've had a motion. I've made the motion to accept the minutes. Sandra has seconded it, and we're just taking the roll to do that.
I would vote aye.
Very good. Gene, I think you're the last.
Aye.
Okay. And I vote aye as well. Okay. Tom, I wanted to just catch you up too, that I went through the sequence of meetings through the end of June, and I've asked you to lead the discussion regarding transportation in April.
Mm-hmm.
And Lou is also interested in that topic, and I would hope that you two can mm-hmm. get together and work out how you intend to focus on that topic. I would appreciate it if all of you, that as your various months come up, if you would just send me a brief outline, tell me kind of what you expect to deal with in that discussion, and give me an idea of how much time you think your discussion should last. I'll deal with it depending on what you tell me. So it would be helpful.
Okay.
All right. For the record, we have unanimously accepted the minutes. And now I'm going to turn it over to Allison.
I have a question. So sure. we accepted the minutes 6-0. Then I make note of who was not present. Does Bobby's vote count to accept minutes? Do we say she's present or not? Like,
she's not present.
Okay, so she's a full board member.
Oh, yes.
Okay, so I know.
Bobby, Cindy, and Virginia not present.
Right.
Okay.
At this stage, I'm not even sure we should list Virginia.
Right, because she has resigned.
She's already resigned. So she's not really a member of the board anymore.
Okay. But in your comments, you're welcome in your comments. Mm-hmm. Or should I say that you shared with us that she did resign?
That's fine.
Okay.
Okay. You all set, Mary Lou?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
So we're just doing the 6-0-0. We're not listing out everybody's names. Right. Okay. Well, happy Valentine's. We've all got our hearts on at the COA today. I included the February newsletter with the packet, just, you know, getting it front of mind so you can see it. Sometimes you look at it often, sometimes you don't. So I just wanted to share with you all the wonderful stuff that we're doing. So seasonal activities are ramping up and becoming very popular. We're busy. The COAs in the local area, I met with them on Tuesday. We usually have a monthly meeting, and everyone has the same feeling, that we're feeling like we're back to where we were. January, we were 70 people a day. So we're busy. It's busy. So there's a lot going on, which is great. It's also tax season. So that's added another layer of people coming into the COA. Last year, we helped over 200 people. So hopefully we'll help the same way. Today, I'm going with Jen from Minuteman Senior Services up to Carlton Willard to talk to them about how we can get the lunch program back at the COA. So before COVID, we had a Monday, Wednesday, Friday lunch. One of their people drove it to us, and we really didn't have to do really much of anything. And it was in the Shawsheen room and served out onto the tables. Now we just have to work logistics. You know, it's in the Flint room now. We need to find volunteers to drive the food. And that was kind of a call to action I put in the February newsletter to see if anyone wanted to help. I don't actually know what it takes to move the food from one place to another. I did ask a courier whether they would be able to do it, like they'd help for the food bank. The problem is they don't transport prepared food. They'll only do like frozen or, you know, shelf stable. So there's a few things to work out, but I'm excited to get that back because we're missing those people. I mean, we're busy even without those people. So it'll be fun when that comes back.
Allison, what was the reference you made? You were going with the who from Minuteman?
Jennifer Stiff. She's the nutritional director at Minuteman. And it's at Carlton Willard. So we're meeting up there. So the way the congregate meal works is that the COA, the town, has a contract with their vendor, and then the food gets delivered and it's straightforward. Carlton Willard is offering us the meal, which is really a great meal for $3. And it's like a contract between Minuteman and us. So we've got to work out those details. So Jen is kind of the lead, but I have to go to see what I'm asking the volunteers to do.
Is that STIFF?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We did apply for the ARPA grant from Minuteman regarding hoarding resources. So that is under review right now. So we've got our fingers crossed and toes as well. It's really wonderful if we get that grant to be able to run a buried in treasures group and provide people with support to help clear out their houses and then have some support after the fact, because it's traumatic to move your house from, you know, cluttered to uncluttered. So we're hoping.
Allison, let me interrupt for 1 minute. I want to just comment on this grant that you sought. The only COA that responded to that RFP was Allison in Bedford. There are two nonprofit agencies that also have applied, but it was the only COA. And
they'll be giving away their surprise.
So,
well, we also would never have been able to get to it if it wasn't for our social work students, because they're the ones that really helped us take the time to look and research and do the application. And then we kind of reviewed it and added our thoughts and feelings as well. So the students are really wonderful that they've got the time to kind of sit and spend to kind of go through the whole thing and then for us to review it. So I'm excited for that. That'd be really something if we got that one.
Is it a state or a federal grant?
It's a federal grant. It's federal money. We had $105,000 to attribute to this grant proposals. Wow.
Yeah.
And I suspect and think that Bedford will do very well in this grant process.
Well, I hope so. That's the goal.
Have you heard officially, Allison?
Yes, we shouldn't. I don't know when exactly, but we're hopeful. This could be the week of a lot of things, so it's exciting for us.
Allison, if we get the grant, who does the work of helping residents clean up their houses? Because that's a huge task.
Yeah, so part of the grant is you have to explain how you would use the grant. And part of it would be to run the Buried in Treasures groups that our social worker, Danica, has been interested in running. So purchasing the books, you know, getting some small things for that program, and then contracting with outside agencies to help with the cleanup. We know of a few companies that we've used before, and then also working with therapists that could help people, you know, with that transition from cluttered homes to, you know, a better living environment. So we're going to contract with a lot of folks as well. So we've put a lot of work into the grant to explain how we'd use everything. But really, it's our social work students and our social worker that would be working on this too. So it's really great. The Buried in Treasures program is quite prescriptive how it works. And we've got the books and you just kind of go through chapter by chapter. And that's a support group in itself, which our social worker is very interested in taking part in. So it's great. It'll be something to add to our programs. And we potentially could do two of these Buried in Treasures groups. Which is great.
What is the first Buried Treasures? Is that what you're saying?
Buried in Treasures.
Buried in Treasures.
Yeah, it's a workbook for folks who want to declutter and get rid of everything in their house. You can purchase it and work on it yourself. So this is a group effort.
Okay. Yeah.
And then two more things on the diversity front. These things just kind of fell into my lap, which are kind of nice. FISCO, which are the Friends of the Indian Seniors, they offered Indian lunch with funding through Emerson Hospital, which is really kind of cool. I'd worked with Rita Shah before in a Chinar program, and she reached out and said, I'd love to offer you this program with Food from Holi. So that's in, I believe it's in the February newsletter, maybe in the March one, maybe March. But that'd be welcoming our Indian neighbors and anyone else who wants to participate. We just have to work out the details early March. And then Minuteman reached out. They also have funding through the Aging Project in Boston, which is an LGBTQ program, to offer startup lunches in the area. So I spoke with them yesterday. I have reached out to Mary Lou as well to see if BD would like to be part of that too. So those things are just kind of like magically happen. So with Mary Lou's plans as well, we're looking good. Mary Lou, I've already done the work. We don't need to do anything else.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We're done.
Yeah, so there's a lot happening, which is really exciting. Does anyone have any questions about any of the reports, so the monthly report, the financials? Go ahead, Sandra.
So, Allison, very exciting on the diversity front. Really appreciate that. I had spoken with Rita Shah about a year ago, and she's a fantastic person, so I'm so excited about that. And also the LGBTQ. My questions relate to the budget. You had mentioned a month or two ago, but I just wanted to make sure I was clear. I'm clear on it. So I know you said that the formula grant is enabling us to fund a couple of things. I'm pretty sure that's where the money is coming from. Are we able to hire a full-time program coordinator, as was our goal last year and didn't get funded? And is that where the money for extending the BLT service to Saturday is coming from, and when does that start?
Okay. So in terms of grant budget updates, what I requested last year was the full-time program coordinator. That was the focus at the time. We weren't allowed to go for full-time, so we did get a part-time person. And then with a bit more education, going to MCOA conferences, we're really in need of a marketing outreach volunteer coordinator, that kind of position. So we didn't think full-time would work. So we went for part-time, which is actually more hours than I asked for last year. So we could only do 10 because the person already had existing hours. So this would be a 19-hour position. So it's more hours than we asked for last year, which is great. So that is coming out of the formula grant if that goes through, which is lucky because we got that bump from EOEA, which is really wonderful. So the BLT, that one's kind of interesting because we had a lot of funds on one side for overtime, which over the years we haven't really used. So that's been rolled in for that additional Saturday position. And that person will also serve as backup for our existing driver. So it's kind of like a twofer on that one, which is really great. When I did the math on it, it wasn't really a big ask for the BLT when we already use the existing things. And of course, our previous driver was more seasoned, so she had more vacation time. So this existing driver doesn't have as much. So we could use that fund to also add to that, the ask as well. So it really was kind of nice that it just worked out that way. So all of that will go through, and then we can kind of rebuild from the back and get us back up to speed again. But full-time, yeah. Not right now. You know, the part-time positions do give us more flexibility in terms of covering the desk and those kinds of things. So that's it for this year. I think it's a good ask, and it sounds like we're supported in those decisions as well.
Great. Thank you.
Mary Lou has a question.
The 19-hour part-time position came out of a formula grant. Is that what you said?
Yes.
So All right.
Yeah, we get a grant from the state based on the number of people who are 65 and older in the town. We had been running on 2010 census numbers for the last 10 years. So with the 2020 census, we were able to get a bump in the payment, which is wonderful. And we're able to hold this position ourselves, which is really simple.
Okay. And yeah. Then the BLT additional funding to cover the Saturday position, who did that come from?
That was within the BLT budget itself. So we just kind of reworked the budget to use existing funds. And it's a very small ask. But it worked out really well.
What are the hours going to be, Allison, on Saturdays?
For Saturday, 10 to 3. So around the same hours that were open at the COA, so people could potentially come to the COA and also do their shopping and all of that. So, I mean, that's the plan. I can look at it a bit more, but that's exciting too. Any other questions on any of the reports that you received? All right, Alan, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Allison. So we'll now turn to the topic of the day, and that's housing options. And I'm going to have Sandra begin opening remarks. Sandra, you're on.
Oh, thanks, Alan. So yes, just to give an overview of the plan, we are honored to have Assistant Planner Catherine Perry and Housing and Economic Development Coordinator or Director Jeffrey King with us today. Catherine, we're very familiar with, and Jeff actually joined us for our discussion of home share programs about a year ago. So thanks to you both for coming and giving us your expertise. So the plan is, Catherine has created a PowerPoint that just gives an overview of the private sector developments and what the planning board is dealing with at the moment in Bedford, both recent, but then also ongoing and looking into the future. So that's going to be our first item, and then maybe take any questions that the board might have. And then both Alan and I have looked into programs. Alan went to talk to someone in Acton. I talked to a couple of people in Carlisle to get a feel for their senior housing developments, which they have dedicated senior housing there. And then Jeff King, I'd love to hear your thoughts on any of that, Jeff. And also, you kindly did a little more research on home share programs and sent a brief report on that, which is very, very helpful. And so any sort of thoughts you might have about whether Bedford might want to pursue that. I think the question is just, given the number of housing developments that are already happening in the private sector, you know, how much, what is the need remaining in Bedford? And what would it look like? Would we pursue standalone senior housing as other towns have done, which is a very complicated process? Would we go on the home share front, which is another, you know, process that we haven't embarked on before and most towns haven't, but that could be pretty interesting. So those are my questions for us today. And we'd love to get the board's thoughts on where we might focus any efforts if we would like to move forward on any of these fronts. Mary Lou.
Before we begin, so the question I have is, if both of these guests are making presentations, do I need to record what they say? Or can I just say they made the presentations and they're included?
Yeah, I think that's fine. I don't think you have to record it. I mean, Allison's recording anyway. So, and you'll have access to the PowerPoint later if you need it. And I'm not sure if Jeff is making a presentation per se, or just sort of giving his comments and updates and thoughts. So anything you would like to provide on that front, Jeffrey, would be welcome. So does that answer your question, Mary Lou?
Yeah, I'll just summarize a major thoughts.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And I can back you up on that. Don't feel like you have to get every word, because more important to me that you, you know, get a chance to listen and participate. So, so great. So with that, I'd like to invite Catherine to speak with us, and Allison is going to give us access to the PowerPoint.
Catherine, are you ready for the PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Do we have access to either of these speakers? Presenters?
You mean their photo, their screen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Why don't we do that after we've done the?
Can you hear me?
Let's do the slides first.
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yes. Thank Good. You.
Okay. Yes, I've just put together a PowerPoint because Sandra asked for an update on housing developments that might be relevant to seniors. And the more notes I made, the more I realized there are quite a lot of them. So I thought it might be helpful for you to have something in writing and then that kind of list numbers of units and so on.
Excellent, Catherine. Thank you.
Okay. I've also done one page on our two-family zoning amendment, but do you want to deal with that separately, Sandra, or do you want me to run straight through into that?
Let's see if anybody has any questions about these initial items.
Yeah,
and the two families housing. A really important topic, because that's something that's coming up.
Right, I'll run through the first slides on the housing developments. Okay, first I thought I'd just give you a refresher on recent construction. I'm sure you're all aware that Carlton Willard expanded with a 12-unit Arlington Court. That opened in 2021. So that added to the independent living portion of the continuing care campus there. So that is one option for seniors. Pine Hill Crossing is just about complete. I've been talking to the developer about finishing off the landscaping, but all of the houses are built now. I'm not sure whether there's still one available for sale, but they're mostly sold anyway. So that's the 29-unit former Coast Guard development. And that's interesting in terms of the size and design of the houses. The small ranches that were renovated are probably about the cheapest houses we've seen on the for sale market as an option for people who are looking for something that's not too expensive. And then the two-story cottages have a ground floor master bed and mostly don't have too many steps up as well. So those could be a good option. And four of the units in the whole development were designated as affordable units. But those were sold a while ago. Village of Bedford Woods is the 40B project on Middlesex Turnpike. That's not that's probably not as suitable for seniors. It's rather isolated. The portion that was built originally was apartments with underneath garaging and elevator, but the phase two of the development that's been substituted for the rest of the development is townhouses in a couple of blocks, but they're less expensive than some of the larger houses for sale in Bedford, so they could be a downsizing option for some people.
Excuse me, Catherine, where is this on
Middlesex? Yeah, this is out on the Billerica line on Middlesex Turnpike. It's opposite the Bedford Woods Office Park. And it's kind of set back. It's got wetlands behind it and it's got commercial development in front of it, so it is somewhat isolated. But, you know, some people may find that it's a nice little community in its own right. And like I say, it's just at a lower price point than some housing. But I think I saw one unit sold recently for 900,000. So that was surprisingly high, to be honest. And that's a condo development. Okay, do you want to go on to the next slide, Alison? Thanks. Under construction now, we have the LCB assisted living development where the planning board created new zoning to enable that and passed a special permit. So that's on South Road on the former construction yard on the corner of Evergreen Avenue. The foundation's in place, but there's a lot of building still to do. That's going to be 92 units, and it's going to include a memory care section. And this is a for-profit model, and it's rental only. So it's different to Carlton Willard in that you don't pay a big lump sum to get in there. You pay month to month. But as I understand it, if people run out of money, they can be evicted. So that is worth kind of bearing in mind. But I think that broadens the opportunities for types of assisted living for people looking for a different model and different price point. And I believe it's going to work closely with the Council on Aging on programming and so on. And it's in quite a convenient location for the heart of town. So for people who've got friends and relatives nearby, hopefully they'll have a better chance of getting visited there than in some isolated place. 310 Great Road, that's the former Papagino's site. Again, construction has just started recently. That's going to be 16 apartments with parking on the ground floor, potentially retail or restaurant on the ground floor. And it will have an elevator. And it's at a bus stop, which is a consideration for some people. There's no affordable units in that one. So that is, I think it's going to be rental, but I'm not 100% sure that it won't be condos. But anyway, those are apartments in a convenient place. Then just approved, this is news, the ZBA approved the 330 South Road development. That's a friendly 40B converting the old barns and farmhouse and adding one more building. So that's going to be 20 units total. There are a range of sizes. Some are apartments, some are townhouses. And the larger units are a new duplex. And that's going to include 20% of units affordable at 50% AMI. So I think that must be four units.
Catherine, just a quick question. So 50% is unusual. It's usually 80%. So that's really good news. Is there right. any kind of... There's no community preservation subsidy for that because we haven't approved that at town meeting, I don't think.
No, I think it was just that the housing partnership thought they would rather have 20% of units at the lower right. affordability level rather than 25% right. at the 80% level. So I think that was the trade-off. Yeah. They felt that this would hit a different bracket where there was a need.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, next slide, Alison. Thanks. So still under consideration, we have the planned residential development on Old Billerica Road, the former Seppi farm. That was put forward for 15 new houses and keeping two existing houses. It was using the density bonus, so that would create two or three affordable units. It's currently on hold with the applicant still having discussions with abutters and sorting out some technical details. So it may come back. It may be revised. So we're waiting to see at that point. But that's the public hearing is open with the planning board still.
Catherine, is this the one that might involve either tearing down or moving Pat Leiby's house over there at 229?
Yes, the proposal is to move it onto a new foundation, but to preserve it, which I believe doesn't require demolition delay because it would not destroy the house, which is kind of the wording used in the trigger for that. So hopefully it would at least keep it intact and visible. I think they're currently discussing the exact footprint to place it on because they were just going to shift it a very small way just to be able to fit the road in. They might be considering moving it a bit further back, but that involves negotiations. then there's the Carlisle Road development being put forward by Brian DeVellis. He originally identified or owns, has control of two parcels of land, and this is the western one of the two. So this is at 82 Carlisle Road and 136B North Road. If you want to find it on the GIS, you could locate it from that. His idea is that he's putting it forward as a friendly 40B. That's not been accepted yet by the town, so it's not officially a friendly 40B, but that's the idea, that it would not need to go through zoning. It would go through the same kind of process as 330 South Road through the, well, eventually with a ZBA comprehensive permit. What he's proposing, this was presented to the planning board and to the housing partnership, and I believe, you know, his current proposal, I believe, hasn't changed from that. He has been asked to give two public presentations, which the last one coincided with the last planning board meeting, and tonight's is going to coincide with tonight's planning board meeting, which is why I've naturally seen that, but I believe it's the same conceptual development. So in terms of
I'm sorry, Catherine, you were going to probably talk about senior housing there.
Yeah, in terms of what that includes, it's a mix. He's proposing a mix of housing, partly to meet the different kinds of needs that people have expressed interest in, and coming out of the housing study, some of the types that have been suggested. And also so that he can make it look more like a single family development along the road front. And then the density increases as you go back with apartments at the back. There's also a lot of wetlands behind that, so there is quite a bit of buffering for neighbours. So that seems like a sensible way to arrange things on the site. In terms of seniors, it includes a 36-unit senior apartment block, which would have parking underneath and an elevator. And the development as a whole would include 25% affordable units at 85% AMI. That's the current proposal. I believe there's been some talk about it being potentially subject to negotiation of deeper affordability levels or more affordable units with a contribution to the town or whatever. The developer's saying that would happen at a later stage, but you know, I'm not involved in the discussions on that, so I'm not saying anything definitive, just that's been floated. So the concept, as I say, has been supported by the Bedford Housing Partnership and by the planning board, but it needs select board support if it was going to advance as officially friendly 40B, and then it would go to DHCD, that's the state agency, to make sure it meets all their rules, and then go to the Zoning Board of Appeals for a comprehensive permit, where they would mainly sort of look a little bit closer at the site details, probably. So that's about as much as I know about it.
This is Alan. I wanted to ask, on the Carlisle Road, the building that's identified as senior apartments, I assume that that's a rental?
I think that's the idea. Sometimes Yeah, I think it is specified as rental. I was going to say if it was a development under zoning, the zoning wouldn't be able to specify what the form of ownership would be. But I believe that's what's proposed.
And do you have any idea about management of that building?
I don't know the detail. You know, there's probably more detail in the official submission. And Jeff King may be able to tell you a bit more because he's probably looked at it more recently or in a little bit more detail than I have.
Okay, thanks.
I have a question, showing my ignorance, but what does AMI stand for?
That's area median income. So it's they start with what is the median income in the area, and then they set the maximum rent as being affordable to someone who earns a certain percentage of that income.
Oh, I see.
So the usual level is 80%. And the income levels are quite high in this area, but then they break them down by household size as well to work out what should be paid by families of different sizes.
Okay, thanks.
And I think it kind of equates to paying a third of, or 30% maybe of your income for housing, something like that.
Okay, thanks. So there's a lot happening, obviously, in the private sector, not all approved, but a lot in the works. And I don't know, we can get back to this later, but I'm actually wondering if we want to send a letter of support to the on the 139 Carlisle Road to the select board, just because it seems so important to have some dedicated senior housing with elevator, with underground parking. It just seems really great to me, but that's a question that the board may want to look at just later in our discussion. So, okay, so Catherine, another interesting project of the planning board is to propose expanded two-family zoning in Bedford at this coming town meeting at the end of March. And maybe you could just really briefly sketch that out for us.
Sure. Alison, can you put up the final PowerPoint slide, which covers that? It's in the same set of slides. Great. Yeah, the planning board is proposing this as a zoning amendment for the upcoming town meeting on March 27th. Amending the two-family zoning was one of the recommendations coming out of the housing study. And the housing study, in turn, came out of the comprehensive plan, which talked about looking at what are the housing needs of the town now that we're above our 10% on strictly affordable housing, were there other missing things that were not being well provided for by the private market, etc. So the current bylaw is very restrictive on two-family houses, even though there is an area of two-family housing that was built early on down in Bedford Gardens. Those little duplexes down there. Later, the bylaw was made more restrictive, and it only allows conversion of pre-1945 houses, and that's by special permit, or it allows new two-family houses on unbuilt lots that have been vacant since 1992 and have 1.5 times the normal lot area. So the last we heard, there were less than half a dozen of those in existence anyway. So you know, virtually a non-starter. So the idea is, in principle, to allow two-family houses as an alternative to single-family houses, but with some kind of size restrictions, so that you wouldn't be getting something that was, you know, absolutely massive and bigger than the single-family houses that are being built. But some of those single-family houses are pretty big. So the board's thinking was, you know, you could perfectly well have a two-family house of moderate size units, which might meet that missing gap in the housing market better than one extremely large house. So the idea is to use a floor area ratio and a lot coverage to, if this is applied to a two-family house, to constrain its overall size. There still wouldn't be any restrictions on one family houses, and it's actually quite interesting if you calculate how big a one family house could be if you built it out to all the setbacks on some of our larger lots. You could have a house that was tens of thousands of square feet, not just several thousand square feet. So houses could continue to get bigger and bigger. We are seeing houses up to 6,000 square feet coming forward these days, which is a lot bigger than single family houses that used to be built in the past. So this would apply in all residential districts. As I said, it wouldn't change the rules for single family houses. If you had an accessory dwelling unit, you wouldn't be able to have the two family house. You can't have them in combination. So the accessory dwelling unit is only for it with a single family house. So it's like an alternative. What else does it do? It removes the special permit requirement for the conversion of the pre-1945 houses, just to make the procedure a bit simpler for them. And it provides some guidance for the ZBA on non-conforming lots, which wants to change to being a two-family house, either by teardown and reconstruction or by addition. The reason that it delves into that is that quite a high proportion of properties are non-conforming in town, particularly in the more central parts of town. So the board wanted to put in some special provisions for that. And I think the ZBA was suggesting that they would welcome a bit more guidance on how to handle two family house proposals on non-conforming lots, because the generalized rules for dealing with non-conforming lots don't give you an awful lot of numeric guidelines, and they were struggling a bit with what is reasonable and what's not. So that's a summary of it. The full text and a more detailed presentation are being put together. Well, the full text has been submitted to the select board, but the more detailed presentation is being worked on by the planning board right now, and it will all be available on the website in the lead up to town meeting. So you'll be able to look at it in more detail there, but I thought I wouldn't set out the whole detailed text here.
Thank you, Catherine. That's really helpful. Yeah, Jean.
Yeah, I have a question on ADUs. Is there any data on how many people are using ADUs or in building them? I apologize, I haven't done bits and bytes in a while, but I came across a New York Times article on senior housing, and they say that the housing that seniors really like was an ADU. I'll share that with everybody. But I was just wondering if any movement with ADUs in Bedford or...
Well, the situation is Bedford has allowed attached or internal ADUs since the early 90s. So that's for about 30 years. And over that time, it's approved about 60 or so. So it's been about two per year on average. So that has made a contribution, I think, to the diversity of Bedford's housing stock. Now, a year or so ago, we amended the ADU bylaw to allow detached ADUs, which weren't allowed before. And that has really not had much uptake so far. I know some people were concerned that there was going to be a sudden rush of these, they're going to be all over town. It's actually the opposite extreme at the moment. And I think it's because they're expensive to construct. The planning board did the site plan review that which was written into the bylaw so that the neighbours could be involved. It did that for one unit. I believe even that one didn't go ahead. I think they opted for an internal one instead, which is possibly for cost reasons. So that hasn't made as big a difference to the supply of that kind of housing as we thought it might. But it might pick up again, you know, the market might change, particularly if maybe manufactured detached units get going more, so that there's a bit more of a ready solution and you're not having to pay an architect. Okay. So I don't know.
I just wondered, is that something to maybe promote, or is that not really our role? I'm not sure if people are imagining it as necessarily a place to put your parents or something like that, but I'll share the article with everybody. And then,
yeah, I think that'll be a good reminder. Thanks, Jean.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it seems as though we've got some interesting options on the table, with more apartments potentially at 139 Carlisle Road and some of the other private sector developments. And then the two-family zoning, which I think are both really important for giving seniors some options. So anybody have any further thoughts or questions or comments on those? Okay, so so Alan and I will just really briefly give an overview of what we found out in talking to Acton and Carlisle about their senior housing developments. Alan, do you want to go first? Or
go ahead.
Oh, okay. So Carlisle has a, they have a Ashby Place type of facility, but that's not connected to the town directly and in any way, except for some of the board members. But that's got a 3 to 5 year waiting list comparable to Ashby Place. So that sort of isn't really what I was investigating. I was looking at Benfield Farms, which is a 26 unit senior housing apartment complex. And I visited it a year or two ago. It's lovely. It's in a very isolated setting. There's nothing else around it. It was built as part of a much bigger parcel of land that the town acquired for $2 million. How they got 46 acres for $2 million, I have no idea, but they did. And so, but it was a very complex process to get it built. The town got some technical assistance from the state to enlist a housing consultant. And then they enlisted Neighborhood of Affordable Housing, which is based in East Boston and manages and develops housing in different locations. NOAA did a lot of outreach in town to find out what people wanted. They responded to the RFP and was selected to actually build the housing. And it's mostly affordable. I think there's two market rate units. It does have an elevator. There's a community room. There's been major problems with it, but of the type that Bedford would not encounter. The sewage and water systems don't work very well. The town gave the developer the specs on that, and they were completely off base because neither of those systems work. And NOAA has had to put in major funding and isn't getting cooperation from community preservation to help with that. But the development was built with a combination of community preservation funds, state funds, which are available for that kind of thing if it's affordable, and private contributions, which you can contribute to an affordable housing development and get a state tax credit, which actually I've used, and it's actually really a great program. But anyway, so it's a complex process. It takes many years. But on the other hand, you know, you come away with some dedicated senior housing. I mean, my personal feeling at this point is that since Brian DeVellis is proposing to build that kind of senior housing at 139 Carlisle Road, that might be a much easier route to go. But anyway, but it's certainly a possibility. We know we have a very strong need in Bedford. So that's the experience in Carlisle. I'm trying to think if I can mention any other. But the residents apparently are constantly, you know, having issues. And I don't know, you know, the NOAA manages the complex, but they don't have anybody on set. So there's been a lot of issues with that. But it is a lovely place, and although very isolated. Okay, thanks. So, Alan, what did you find out in talking with folks in Acton?
Acton has about 90 units in more than one location. The largest portion of them are in a facility, a series of buildings that is very similar to Ashby Place. It's two floors. It has no elevator. I think the funding that was used to build it was probably the same as Ashby Place. It's low income, strictly. So you have to be eligible to live there. There are no services provided. That struck me as a bit of a stressful situation. But I was told that Minuteman does.
What do you mean by saying there are no services available. Like what?
Of any type, Tom. And they're pretty much independent living. The town doesn't provide, although it does provide a manager for the facility. It's not a single facility. There are two floors, and they're really built more like a townhouse design. Each one has a separate entry to it. I think it's four units off of a single entry. And so does that answer your question, Tom?
No, but it's okay.
It could be, I think, different kinds of social services.
Definitely, and health services.
Yeah, support, kind of supportive, what's known as supportive housing, where depending on what people need, the town would try to provide, to link up with those kinds of services.
Minuteman Senior Services has stepped in and does visit the facility regularly. And they provide some assistance for folks who might look for some kind of service, whether it's health related or otherwise social. The same problem as Ashby Place is the wait list. I was told that it could be 3 to 5 years before one reaches eligibility. And because there's no elevators, they also accommodate moving people from the second floor to the ground floor when they have an opportunity to do so. So people move around a little bit. Overall, it struck me as being very similar to Ashby Place with its failings. Lack of an elevator. And the otherwise access or limited access for services struck me as a negative for sure.
So each apartment is on one floor or the other, but half of them are on the second floor.
And that's correct.
You have to go up the stairs to get there. Okay.
You got it, Tom.
Go ahead, Alison.
Is one location right next to the Council on Aging, the new building for Acton? I think there's one close by.
I did not see it, no. And I wound up wandering around a little bit. So, no, I didn't see it. I understood that there was a new COA building.
Yeah, I don't think funding of that type is available to create housing anymore. I could be completely wrong, but the federal government has cut way back on any kind of available funding.
The one thing I pressed to my contact about is that she claims that the town stepped forward, that the town government provided the area in which the buildings could be built, and the town meeting very widely supported the development of those units. I was told it was like 91% at town meeting, and they continue to be concerned about housing. As are we. Catherine, I want to thank you for giving that inventory. That's very helpful. And there's a lot more going on than meets the eye. That's nicely done.
Okay, well, thanks, Alan. So not last but not least, Jeffrey King, if you have any thoughts about how, you know, the situation with potential housing for seniors in Bedford and whether home share is something that is that might be viable. Like, I believe that you, in your research, you found that, you know, a social service agency could can spearhead that kind of thing. And maybe Minuteman would be the avenue for that if Bedford wanted to join with other towns and pursue it. But anyway, your thoughts about any of this are welcome. And Allison, can we put Catherine or Jeff on this screen so we have a little bit more intimate feel? Or
it's up to them whether they show the camera or not.
Okay, well, it's up to you. It's not a big deal. So it's the floor is yours, Jeff.
Thank you. If I could just take a moment to add to a couple of things that you had asked about. First of all, about Carlisle Road project and the senior designed facility. The 26 units, which is rental, will be marketed and designed for 55 plus. It can't require only 55 plus the way that as a 40B project. So they're adding elevators, adding different rails and other amenities are oriented towards 55 plus. It's a 26 unit multi-story with elevators and all of those for rent. And if I also could add, there's one other project that had kind of started and stopped and now starting again is 100 Plank Road, which is right off of Middlesex Turnpike, 54 units, all one person units. They are 25% affordable. They've got the foundation in and should be starting construction soon. They still need to go through their 40B, which is known as a LAU, slightly different than a LEP project, for getting their affordability approved. They'll be coming back to the Housing Partnership for support and approval. They came back initially. It looked pretty good. I think we were just looking at a better dispersion or equal dispersion of the affordable units so they're not clustered and ensuring there's access to sufficient parking, which is some of the surface parking is shared with the units next door.
Jeff, if you drive down Plank Road,
yeah,
there is a construction project that looks for all the world like it's an extension of Taylor
Pond. Village of Taylor Pond.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And is that the new one that you're talking about? Or is-
yes.
Okay.
Yeah. In fact, they're going to have some shared parking between the two. I think at one point it was a single owner and then it was split off and Greylock is building this new one. It'll have 6,000 square feet of commercial on the first floor and the rest is all elevated residential, one bedroom units. If I could, I'm going to reprise the original report from last June as far as home sharing and to start with a definition that seemed to be fairly common among some of the different programs, and that is that home sharing enables two or more unrelated people to share housing for their mutual benefit. A person offers a private bedroom and shared common area in exchange for rent, help around the house, or a combination of the two. Every home sharing agreement is unique. It's about people helping people. Obviously, there's a growing need because of both the need for affordable housing, the growth of the senior population, and we've seen pretty significant growth of, well, first of all, households age 65 to 74 and certainly above, but particularly those with severe rent burdens. And that's, you know, part of one of the driving issues right now. Of course, we're in a pretty significant crisis with affordable housing in the Boston metro area. And so when we looked at this, that there are a number of benefits that are front and center, certainly the affordable housing aspect for younger people. There's a shared living agreement, there are money saved by the senior, as well as the younger person renting, shared utility costs, reduced financial stress, increased security. The best programs have background checks and then a shared living agreement. When we looked at these The most significant models were nonprofits. Most of these are programs that are provide services. And I guess the way to look at them, there's some common practices for the best programs. One, that they have usually a website where there's an application for a tenant. There's a tenant application that they need to produce, the same for an elder applicant. And then there's the most important part is an agreement that is then put together that goes through different strategies of expectations, guidelines, including exit strategies if someone wants to leave. But a lot of these, like I said, are nonprofits that charge the home provider and home seeker minimal fees. And the programs are sustained through mostly fundraisers, grants, donations. Some have gotten contributions from government or from different communities. What's interesting is most are regional in nature, either as a cluster of communities, one county or multiple counties. So we found in terms of scale, a lot of them that are, in fact, is actually a nonprofit association out there for these shared homeowner type programs. And the fees generally range from $30 to $85 for the applicant and for the senior. Again, looking at these, that again, most, but not all, are for adults 55 plus, you know, paired with a younger adult. And all of them have, you know, websites with a downloadable application. The thing about replicating the most important parts with the applications are already out there. There are a number of different models, but examples of good applications, good home share agreements, and good design. But most of these, the type of organizations are nonprofits around either affordable housing and homelessness, or social services or programs for seniors. That seems to be the predominant type of organization that, and most of them are not set up solely for home sharing. In other words, this is another service or program that they offer to their existing organization. So I looked at, you know, some of the operations and what are some of the commonalities, what are some of the core pieces that are needed for a successful home share program. And as I've already mentioned, they all have websites with access to online or downloadable applications, along with other program information or services in addition to home sharing. Again, some of these have wraparound or other services, and this is just part of their mission. Not all. I mean, there are some dedicated just to home sharing. And so they have a comprehensive home provider application. They have a comprehensive home seeker application, as I meant. And program staff maintains a list of home providers and home seekers, and then they also work to make the introductions. An important component is the follow-through, and that is that they review staff, program staff review references and background checks of both parties. The safety and security part is really paramount. The program staff will perform interviews of both parties. They will facilitate often in-person matching introductions. And then, as I said, the final key ingredient is a home share agreement. The agreement spells out obligations such as rent amount, due date, hours, and types of services involved, whether smoking or other activities are allowed. The staff executes the home share agreement. Now, some of these share agreements as a way of cutting costs further. The younger tenant agrees to perform certain services. It might be taking out the trash or doing something like that. So they're flexible of what can be developed. And the best of these organizations, they provide match care and ongoing support, which may be as simple as a periodic phone call up to a quarterly on-site visit. And in some programs, staff will help mediate any disputes that arise if needed, and if needed, prepare an exit agreement. A number of these organizations do have some kind of social service worker on staff or that they have access to.
Go down in the elevator from upstairs.
And I also looked at the because I guess they also had made a proposal is the for-profit model Nestle. And the differences there is that they're very tech heavy. A lot of it's done, you know, on site, and I don't think there are a lot of services. It does require applications, background checks, reference checks, and again, such as the agreements. They also charge a one-time fee that ranges from $95 to $195 for the individuals using the service. Now, where their for-profit model is a larger fee for the sponsoring organization. And they've done some that are a much larger, Boston Metro, Louisville, Kentucky, Greater Columbus, and they seem to have all partnered with Greater Lynn Services, Senior Services, ended up to be just a one-year pilot. So often Nestle will link up with an existing sponsor. And they
we just have a few minutes left. So I just want to, don't necessarily want to go into all the details here. I just wanted to get an overview of that. So, right.
Yeah, I just, lastly, Nestle charges a 2.5% fee on annual rent of the home seeker. So the question is, could it be, you know, done in Bedford? I guess there are two approaches to take. One would be that regional model, so you can, you know, get again a larger base of both home seekers and those that have homes available. And again, maybe seek out nonprofits, maybe other councils of aging, maybe regional nonprofits around housing or homelessness or other social services. The other way, if you were to do it locally, it almost would be a bootstrap operation. Maybe you could get also contributions or support from the community or from the church, some involved churches, because you would need, you know, again, a lot of this can be put on website, and but you would need, you know, probably access to existing staff. Let's say we did it, you looked at town of Bedford, looking at existing staff, we're adding some of their time, whether it's a social worker or a council of aging or someone else to do, because again, as it'd be a much smaller level, there'd be a lot fewer applicants. So whether you could scale down, you could. I think it could work. Whether it be as effective as something regional, I'm not sure. But you could take either approach or look into either approach.
Great. Well, thank you, Jeff. So it seems to me we've heard a ton of information. One is that there's a lot going on in Bedford, and that there's two possibilities that are really active, but not complete right now in terms of what we could sort of keep in mind, which is one is the 139 Carlisle Road development, which is under consideration by the select board, and the other one being the two-family zoning. And I think they're both really important. I don't know if there's any appetite among the board to support those formally, either with the select board with the 139 or the two-family at town meeting, but I personally would strongly endorse both of them. And so that's a possibility.
Yeah, I will tell you that the Bedford Housing Partnership in concept supported Carlisle Road as well as the two-family bylaw. And I guess recently, and Bofa, you could correct me, I think the select board endorsed the two-family bylaw.
Yes, we did. We voted to recommend the approval of that article.
Great. So thanks. So yeah, I personally plan to, I think I hope to maybe write a letter to the select board supporting 139 Carlisle Road, because I think it's important to reiterate the need for senior housing, whether it goes forward in that exact iteration or not. I think it's really important to hear that the senior community, you know, from members of the senior community, that it's about its importance. I don't know if anybody from the board wants to join me or we want to take a vote on that, but that's my hope is on that one. It's like, that is a concrete thing that the private sector developer has proposed that could move forward without the huge amount of effort entailed in the Carlisle and Acton developments, which I'm not necessarily seeing that we could pull off right now in Bedford. Correct me if you disagree, Alan. So that's one possibility. The other possibility I see for the potential home share is to maybe approach Minuteman Senior Services to see if that's something, and have a conversation with the director, executive director, to see if that's something that they would potentially consider. And it's a longer term, probably, proposition. They'd have to really think about it. They have a, you know, you have a board. It strikes me as something that they could spearhead if they wanted to wrap it in with their other services, and the services would be available to the. It just strikes me as that would be the way to go. I don't necessarily see Bedford doing on it. It's on its own. So I don't know if anybody has any comments on those two things.
Yeah. So on the latter one, wasn't it Nesterly that you sponsored coming in and presenting to us last year?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if we were going to support, do we have any reason to have a bias towards Nesterly? Or are you just throwing it out that we would do it with any home share agency that was a good fit for Bedford with Minuteman Services as a partner?
I'm throwing it out is because one of the key points that Jeff made is that there's often a nonprofit involved that spearheads the program. And so, and he mentioned a social services organization, and Minuteman is one that we work with often. It's a great organization. The director is amazing. And so it just strikes me that that might be something that they might consider. I don't see it happening overnight, but it might be something that we would want to have a conversation. Either personally, Alan, you're on the board, you know, two of us, I don't know, could approach Jen. It's just a possibility. Beyond that, I don't necessarily see Bedford moving ahead. Allison had the thought that MAGIC, the regional planning organization that we're involved with, might pursue it. But right now it's not on their plate. But I think that's a possibility. But I don't know. I just think it could be something that we want to keep active. On the other hand, we have these definite proposals in front of us and that we could choose to support or just know about them and spread the word.
Jeffrey, I have a follow-on question for you. You made a point of mentioning that Nesterly was a for-profit organization versus the other descriptions were all for nonprofit. Are you suggesting that one is better than the other if we were to push for this with Minuteman Services?
No, they're just different models, and they the difference with Nestle is they seem to have they're tech heavy, so those that are more comfortable with tech, and they do allow for all ages. But again, they can be any of these programs can be developed or customized to particular needs. But no, I can't really say that one is necessarily better than the other. We're just okay.
The other possibility is that Community Preservation Committee, at least one member, Margaret Fleischman, has opened the door to some funding for senior housing. She's interested. She said that they're interested in proposals from us or whoever on senior housing. And so if we did go on the home share route, it would probably require a contribution from the town. And so it seems to me that a very modest amount of money per year could go a long way toward funding our actually, though, you know what? It would have to be affordable. So I don't know how that would work, but we'd have to look into it. The community preservation would have to be affordable housing. So, but anyway, that struck me as a possibility for finding the funding for that if we wanted to move ahead. But that, so it's a bigger question. I just thought I'd reiterate, since Jeff was kind enough to do this research at our request, that's still a possibility. But I don't know if people have any thoughts about, you know, expressing support for these other two family and Carlisle Road, or whether we're just interested to know about it and spreading the word that they could be very important for seniors. I think the two family would be kind of amazing for seniors because it would give more affordable, though not deeded affordable housing, as opposed to a very large home that really is not going to be what most seniors are going to want.
I will share with you my perspective in terms of how we support this if we do. There's no question in my mind that we need housing, especially for elders. And anything that will produce it and the variety of approaches that have been identified here today are plus. And I have no hesitancy in supporting that effort in its broadest sense. Where I get a little bit troubled is to express a view as to a single entity. That suggests that we're going to evaluate these as they come along, and whether we support one or don't support another, that strikes me as it leaves us open for some criticism. I would want to reflect on this possibility for at least until the next meeting. If we want to present and vote on the recommendation, then I would urge that we hold off until the March meeting to actually vote. We take a look where we can see what the impact on the neighborhood would be, whichever entity we're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah. So that's thanks.
Yeah,
that makes sense.
That's my perspective.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thanks, Alan. So yeah, I won't be at that meeting, so I don't know if it makes any sense. I might just do this as an individual, but if folks want to consider that the next meeting, that would be great. Either one. But I agree, it's a bigger question. It's a bigger picture. You need to know a lot about the Carlisle Road development, even though we heard from Brian Develops a year and a half ago, he did present to us. Yeah. And we have pretty good information on the two family at this point. So I don't know, any further thoughts from other board members?
I have a question. So as a result of your research, Alan and Sandra, you really just mentioned one large entity for each town. And today we've been exposed to several efforts for new construction and future plans. So I'm a little unclear on, are you saying that you feel that we're behind these neighboring towns? Or, I mean, were you trying to make a comparison, establishing that we're doing a good job or we're not doing a good job?
Sandra, I'll entertain your thoughts too, but my response to that would be, I went there really with an open mind to see what has been done in Acton, what their view was of housing shortage, in effect. I didn't come with any agenda, and I didn't really take an agenda away. I think the discussion here today tells me there's a lot more going on than even I had envisioned.
So
I hadn't graded them in terms of the approach.
Thanks, Alan.
Try to get a grasp of what's currently available and what's coming down the pike. Sandra, your perspective?
Yeah. We know we need more senior. I think we know we need more senior housing given the waiting list at Ashby Place. I think a lot of different options, as Alan said, which we've seen, are helpful. The question that I kind of approached Carlisle with in my own mind was, is this something we could pull off? And do we get, and what I came away with is it's an enormous amount of effort. And given the amount of activity in Bedford, I'm not sure that we need to go that route yet. And Allison, you might have some thoughts about that.
Allison, before you jump in, Sandra, I think maybe you mentioned this too, but I was told about the wait list in Acton and the problem with this wait list is that it draws from residents anywhere in Massachusetts.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you can't really earmark the
right
housing that's available in the community for exclusive use of residents of that community.
Exactly. I think I was a little bit confused on this. Carlisle said something about a 70% local preference, but that seems really high to me. I'm not sure that's really the number. Right. But I agree. You can't build housing in Bedford and restrict it only to Bedford residents.
So the concern that ran through my mind as I was learning of this is, while on the one hand it appears that there are various options available for housing, it might not go to residents of Bedford.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We know there's a regional need and we'd be contributing to that. And that would be very, very important. I mean, Bedford needs housing, but so does everybody else. And so we would definitely be serving a need. Allison, did you have, I know we need to wrap up. Did you have any quick thoughts, Allison?
Yeah.
No, I think just thank you very much, Catherine and Jeffrey. I'd actually forgotten some of those developments. So there's a lot going on. I think just keeping people aware of what's happening, and I always have the concern about what affordable means, you know, the big A and the little A. So we've always had that kind of worry that seniors are often priced out of the new developments. So, I mean, there's always that, but I would also question the 4 to 5 year wait list on those other places when Ashby is like 7 to 11 years. So general wait list everywhere. I think there's potential for the home share, but as Jeffrey mentioned, there's a lot of pieces to it. It sounds like a partnership with someone at some point for that could be a solution, but there's a lot of things that come with that too. So I think there's a lot going on. Thank you again, Catherine and Jeff, for everything you're doing and really keeping an eye on what's happening and supporting those things that are going to help the seniors.
Yeah, and I just mentioned just a final comment about the affordability. Each one of these developments has a significant affordable component to it. So that I think is really promising.
Allison, can you send out the slides with that Catherine was working from? Can you send that out to individuals? Thank you, Catherine and Jeffrey, both. We appreciate your time here today. And Bopa, you kind of snuck in on me, but I appreciate the fact that you were able to get here. Do you have a quick comment or two?
Sure. Sorry for being late, and sorry my computer ran out of battery and had to come back on. I do want to clarify the two family recommendations by the select. But we did recommend it. There were 4 of us and 1 disapproval, but overall, that was a majority. So just an FYI. Select Board, we closed the town warrant last night. As you all may know, there's 22 articles. ATM is on March 27th, and please be aware of time change. It's going to start at 6:30 at high school auditorium. As you may know as well, the town is conducting a survey, an annual town meeting survey. You can either, it's been posted on Facebook, different places as well. We would love to hear everyone's voice in order to, you know, try to make our town meeting better. So that will be due on April 3rd, so please take some time to give us some feedback so that we can, you know, try to make town meeting as accessible and, you know, as convenient for everyone to be able to participate. Last night, we appointed 6 individuals to the fire station building committee. So that was done last night, and we are going soon to be selecting, we're going through a process of selecting a designer and architect, and that should be done sometime in March. have, I've been listening to your conversation about the Develis group and reminder, again, I think Catherine or Jeff had already, or someone else had already mentioned that there's a forum tonight at the Read Room at 7 p.m. If you can't attend, you can actually watch it on Bedford TV, YouTube as well, and listen to it. At this point, the select board had asked the developer to complete a list of things before they come to us for, or the developer comes to us for, to present to us. So so right now there is that forum and it will be recorded. And Alan, you had talked about, you know, going into Acton, and it made me think when I was a liaison to the Municipal Affordable Housing Trust, Christina had done some work in taking a look at other towns and what they're doing as well in regards to, as you know, the Housing Affordable Trust, they're, you know, they're housing, not just particularly seniors, but just, but housing. But I wonder if you and Christina, I don't know if you know Christina Wilgren already, and if not, I can do an introduction to you both. And I feel that some of the things that you're saying, she has done a lot of work and looking into it already as well, that I think maybe you guys should talk. And maybe you may not have to do a lot more since she was looking into other towns as well. So just an FYI. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Is Christina a Bedford employee or?
Christina is chair of the Municipal Affordable Housing Trust, which is a town committee here as well in Bedford as well.
Oh, okay.
Sandra, do you know her?
Yes, I know Christina. I'll be in touch with her.
Yeah, and she chairs the housing partnership as well. And I think she's on the CPC as well. So I think it's always good because everyone's doing the same thing, but different things and reinventing it when, you know, if just in case she has already has all the information, you may just want to talk to her about it.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
Thank you both.
Yep.
Are you having coming to the COA?
Me? Sure. I am. I'm supposed to be there on the 28th, right, Allison? I typically go at 2:00.
Okay. I'm going to try and stop by.
Yes, please do. I have a lot of fun there. So I always have a blast.
Wouldn't mind fun.
One last thing. Bopa, just a heads up, I sent you an email with a few questions regarding diversity.
Yep, I saw that, Mary Lou, and let's connect. I will. I apologize that my work has some pipes burst and the last week has been miserable for me, but I did see the email, but let's connect my phone because I do have some ideas for you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you all. We're out of time.
Alan, Susan does have her hand raised.
Okay. Susan, can you be short?
Yes, I was planning on it.
Very good.
So just real quick, COVID and the flu are still out there. So continue mitigation strategies, vaccinate and test and everything. I just wanted to bring everyone's attention at the last Board of Health meeting, Chris Bang, who is one of the town social workers, presented to us on all the supports offered to Bedford residents. And thanks to the citizen, they actually put a summary of his presentation in the citizen yesterday. So there are links on our web pages and the town web pages, but I just recommend everyone look at it because there are a lot of challenges right now for all the residents, and just know all the supports that Donica and Chris and Mallory provide is just great. So I just wanted to highlight that and then thank the board, because last time we spoke, you all endorsed the Bedford Safe campaign that is moving forward. Off the Bedford Board of Health website, there is a lot of information to drive education and awareness. And there will be a mailing to every household. It should come out this week. And then also on March 1st, we have a community forum at the high school from 7 to 8. So just thank you to everyone on the board for your endorsement. And Bob, I see you on as well. So thank you to the select board for their endorsement as well. And I just welcome anyone who's listening to today and you all to join us on the 1st.
Thank you, Susan. All right. I will make a motion to adjourn. Is there a second? Lou? Okay. And we'll take the vote. Sandra?
Aye.
Mary Lou?
Aye.
Lou?
Aye.
Jean?
Aye. That was me.
And Tom?
Aye.
And I vote aye as well. So we are adjourned until March 14th. Same time, same place. Thank you all.